I'm Tyra Krause from Statens Serum Institute in Copenhagen, Denmark, and I'm going to give you this presentation on opening of schools, the Danish public health experience. I'm a medical epidemiologist by training, and I work with the surveillance of infectious diseases at Statens Serum Institute in Denmark. So I'm going to talk briefly about the background, the evidence for children and their risk of COVID-19. Then I'm going to talk about the Danish healthcare and the COVID-19 surveillance systems, and then talk you through the Danish experience. And I'm going to show you some age stratified data on COVID-19 test and positive incidence, so you can see the age specific transmission patterns. And then I'm also going to talk a bit about age-specific transmission patterns in households. And finally, I'll come to some conclusions, I hope. So this technical report came out from ECDC in the beginning of August, where they provide the evidence for COVID-19 in children and the role of school settings in COVID-19 transmission. And some of the key messages from this report was that only a small proportion of the overall COVID-19 cases that have been reported in Europe are among children aged below 18 years. And they've also found that children are less likely to be hospitalized and have fatal outcomes compared with adults. Children are more likely to have mild or asymptomatic infection. And when they're symptomatic, children shed virus in similar quantities to adults, and they can also infect others in a similar way as adults. It is unknown how infectious asymptomatic children are. There's only been reported few significant outbreaks of COVID-19 in schools, and even though we know that they do occur, maybe they are difficult to detect because the children have relatively few or mild symptoms. Some studies, seroprevalence studies, not so many have been done comprising children also, but they've shown that they have a slightly lower seroprevalence of antibodies compared to adults. And then investigation of cases identified in school settings suggest that child-to-child transmission in schools is uncommon and not the primary cause of SARS or COVID-19 infection in children. And finally, there's little evidence of the effect of school closures. So with all this information in mind, I'll walk you through the Danish experience. So Denmark has about 5.8 million inhabitants, so it's a bit bigger than Denmark. There's a free access to healthcare, and all laboratories serving the healthcare system are public. Currently, the recommendations for COVID-19 testing is that all patients with COVID-19 symptoms, also mild symptoms, are offered test. And we also recommend testing of some asymptomatic persons, and that's close contacts to confirmed cases, which are recommended to be tested at day 4 and 6 after exposure. And that's in order to avoid quarantine. So they have to stay isolated until their first negative test if they've been in close contact with a confirmed case. We also recommend testing of all patients at or before hospital admission to avoid introduction of viruses in hospitals. And then we also do extensive testing in case of outbreaks. So if there's an outbreak in a nursing home, it's recommended to test all the inhabitants in the nursing home, but also all the healthcare workers in the nursing home. And they have to be tested every week for a long period until the outbreak is over. When it comes to school, the recommendation is that if there's one case in a school or in a school class, you only have to identify the close contacts in the class. You don't have to close down the whole class. Identify contacts and test contacts. And it's only if you have more than one case in a class that you will recommend all the class to be locked down or recommend the pupils to isolate themselves. So With this, it's also there's a political incentive in Denmark that every Dane should have access to a test, even if they haven't got any symptoms. Also, if it's just because they want to feel secure in one way or the other, either because they are in close contact with some vulnerable people, or they are concerned that they can transmit the disease to others. So this slide shows the number of COVID-19 tests that have been taken in Denmark, the weekly number of tests, and you can see that in the last week we have tested almost 220,000 people every week. It's more than 30,000 tests a day, which is quite a huge amount. We have two tracks of two different test systems. We have the healthcare track, and that's they're located at the hospitals, and that's where patients with symptoms are being tested. And then we have a community track, and we have, I think, 18 tents all over the country where people can go and get tested if they haven't got symptoms. So that's the close contacts and also people working in different occupations, or people who have to go to hospital before and need to have a negative test before that. So I'll just talk you briefly through our surveillance system. In Denmark, we have a microbiology database, and it comprises all Danish microbiology laboratories, and it holds person identifiable information on all national microbiology test results, positive as well as negative results. So when a doctor requires a test taken, the test or the material will go to the clinical laboratory, and then a test result will go to the person who required the test taken. But a copy of this test result will also go into this database called the microbiology database. Patients or persons who have been tested also have access to the test result on a web portal called Sundhed.dk, and that's like Health.dk. Health IR, if it was in Ireland. So the way our surveillance systems work is that we identify all patients that have been tested for COVID-19 in the microbiology database. We link with our national patient register to see whether they have been hospitalized, whether they have received intensive care, or whether they have underlying diagnosis with different chronic diseases. That's to identify if they belong to a risk group. Then we also link with the civil registration systems, so we know the age and the address of the person and the date of death if they die. We know their ethnicity, and we can also link them to households, and that's important for some results I'm going to show you on household transmission rates. We also have information on occupation and workplace from some special registers, so we can identify healthcare workers, but also other groups, and I'm going to present some data on COVID-19 testing of teachers. And we can also identify people living at nursing homes and also staff connected to nursing homes, which has also been very helpful for the surveillance of transmission at nursing homes. And the reason we can do this is that all persons in Denmark have a unique identification number that is also used for all these registers. So this is just to say that the pattern that was described by ECDC is the same in Denmark. This slide shows the distribution of confirmed cases in age groups. So the second column is the confirmed cases, and in the third column you can see the number of tested people in the different age groups, and you can see the percentage of positive tests. So what we see is that less than 2,000 of the confirmed cases in Denmark have been among children aged below 19 years. And you can also see that the percentage of positive samples is lower among the children than among the adults, in particular among those less than 10 years of age. We can also see this slide shows the number of confirmed cases by age group and the number of hospital admittances by age group. And we can see that less than 50 children have been admitted to hospital. So that's also only a few percent of the confirmed cases, which is much lower compared to other age groups. So this just confirms what ECDC also described in their technical report. So this is the Danish IPI curve of confirmed cases over time. And you can see that we had a huge increase in the number of cases in February and March. And on the 12th of March, we went from containment to mitigation. So we stopped doing contact tracing, and we stopped. We started only to test people who had severe symptoms, and that's why we see this drop in the number of cases. We also started the lockdown of the society on the 12th March. So school closures, closure of workplaces, closure of cafes, restaurants, bars, the cultural life, everything. So it was a huge lockdown. And in spite of the lockdown, we still saw this increase in the number of confirmed cases until the beginning of April, where we kind of had the peak. We opened the kindergarten, then we saw a decrease, and then we opened the kindergarten and the first to fifth grade of schools by the 16th of April. It was a gradual opening. Not all schools were ready at this date, but then they were ready in the week after. And we had expected that we would see an increase due to the opening, but actually what we saw was a continuous decrease. Then 1 month later, we opened for the schools, the grades 6th to 10th grade. And in this period, we also opened bars and some cafes, supermarkets, shopping malls. And you can see we still saw this continuous decrease in the number of cases. And that's in a period where we also increased the test capacity a lot. I can see there's a wrong date here. The summer holiday day starts at the end of June in Denmark, and you can see over the summer there was, we still had very low numbers of cases, and then it started. We saw a decrease by the end of July, and peaking mid August, and we also saw an increased number of cases in children in this period, but it was due to some quite localized, geographical localized outbreak, particularly among some ethnic minorities that also had very big families, which meant that a lot of these children, they were actually detected by contact tracing activities within these families, and many of them didn't have any symptoms at all. So this increase we actually saw before the start of school. And when the school started, and since the schools have started, we have seen a decrease again. So just to show you that the increase, the surge in cases we saw in August is not due to the school openings. So under what conditions did the school open up? There were some quite strict recommendations. Of course, children have to stay home when they're ill, and children are sent home for testing even if they have very mild symptoms. So I'm working from home today. That's because my son has caught a cold and I've had to bring him for testing because otherwise he's not allowed to go to school. I'm sure it's just a rhinovirus or something else, but I mean, he cannot go to school with symptoms. They have increased focus on hand hygiene, so they wash hands, I think, between every lesson they have in school. And my son has hand eczema, and it has really been a problem for him with all this hand washing and cleaning. They also needed to keep physical distance, so in the beginning it was 2 meters between each pupil, but it was changed to 1 meter I think it was about mid-May when the second half of the schools opened up. And then they do a huge effort to avoid crowding by entrances and toilets. Also they try to reduce contacts in schools, so they have established play groups and also play zones where the groups play in the schoolyards so that they don't mix together. And they also recommended to have play dates within their play groups after school so that they don't mix too much. So this is just to show what some schools have done to avoid crowding here. The children are only allowed to use every second tap when they do their hand washing to allow for physical distancing. Here they try to ensure safer flow of pupils in the schools, in and out of schools. The same here at staircases that in some schools can be quite narrow. They've also made these drop zones for parents, so you're not allowed as a parent to go with your child into the school. You have to drop them off, and then they are allowed into the school in smaller groups. And also a lot of initiatives have been implemented to nudge the children to keep distance to each other. So this slide shows the COVID-19 incidence by age, and we use a 7 days rolling average by week. And you can see here that I've marked here when the kindergarten opened for these, and you can see there was hardly any increase in the number in the incidence of cases. And you can see the other lines here corresponds to the other age groups. You can see a little bump here, and I'll explain to you afterwards why this occurs. And this was also the same for the school children in the small lower grades. When you look at the higher school grades, it's the same, 13 to 19 years of age, no increase at all after the school opening mid-May for these age groups. So, and what is this about this little bump we see here? Yes, this slide shows the test incidence. And as I showed you, the capacity has increased immensely over time, and that also means that the test strategy has changed a bit. So just here when we saw the bump, that was where we had the change where we started to recommend testing of closed contacts to confirmed cases. And I think this meant that we suddenly detected more cases among the children. So children that may have been asymptomatic were suddenly tested because they were close contacts. But as you can see here, this increased number of testing did not really result in a lot of more cases. We can also see this change, and that has been over the summer, this peak. And I think it's because parents have had their children an increased awareness of testing their children either before and also after travel during the summer holidays. And as explained before, we can see this increased incidence among children for the last weeks, and particularly in this age group. And this is due to these very geographical limited outbreaks in some certain ethnic groups. So I think they can be attributed to the contact tracing activities within these groups. So it's not really a trend we see in the whole country. And the most important thing is that this increase starts before school opens and kindergarten opens. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about household transmissions. So we have done this study where we identified cases in the period from February 27th to July 24th. And we linked all the cases with their addresses, and then we could identify households with at least one positive case. And we assume that the first positive case in a household is the primary case. We cannot be certain about this because maybe there has been another person in the household who has had symptoms before this case that tests positive the first time. But this is the only way we can do it. So we don't have information on symptom onset in our surveillance system. So we have identified 6,700 primary cases. And then we look in the household and see how many are in the household. And we see 14,000 people, 14,000 people live in the households. Of these, 6,000 have been tested as secondary cases, and some of these, almost 2,000, have tested positive. So this is the data set we work with, and I'm going to show some things we have studied within this data set to analyze transmission within households. So this slide shows the share of potential secondary cases tested and who test positive for each primary case. So this slide shows the dates since the first positive test in the household, and this shows the share of the other household members that are being tested. So we see that within 7 days of the first case in the household testing positive, 80% of the household members have been tested, and among those, 15% test positive. So we have a household attack rate of 15%. So it seems as if this system, where we recommend testing of close contacts, works quite well, although not 100% tested. This slide is quite interesting because in this we try to see what is the share of the total number of cases we see that are due to transmissions within households. So, and what we can see is that during the lockdown, we see a decrease in the share of household transmissions. So somehow during the lockdown, your family is a kind of bubble where you avoid to get virus into the family, and therefore you see less household transmission during lockdown. When we opened the society up, we see an increasing proportion of household transmissions, and that's because now you suddenly open up and you can get infected outside and bring the infection into the family, and then it can result in household transmission within the family. What is interesting is that we see that during the school holidays, we see a decrease in the share of household transmission of the total number of transmissions. So we actually see a kind of a lockdown pattern during the summer holiday. When we look at the age-specific attack and transmission rates, and I have to say this is unpublished data, it's still under submission, we can see that the attack rate within household is lower for the children, so they're less likely infected compared to older people in the household, which are more likely to be infected. When we look at the probability of infecting others, we can see that children are more likely to infect others in their household, and that is the elderly people in a household are also more likely to infect others in the family. And maybe this has to do with the contact patterns that small children have closer contact with others, and maybe also the older people in the family are more likely to have closer contact with others because maybe they need some special help and assistance, so they have closer contact. That could be one explanation. These figures are heat maps of the probability of being tested and the probability of testing positive if you're a secondary case in the household. So what we can see here that if there's a higher probability of being tested as a secondary case when a child is the primary case. And I think that's the explanation we saw before, that children have a closer contact with all other family members, and therefore they are more likely to be tested independent of the age group. When we look at the probability of testing positive as a secondary case, depending on the age of the primary case, we can see that actually the risk is highest among the elderly to the elderly. And I think we saw that the attack rate was increasing with age, and we also saw that the risk of infecting others increased with age. So it seems that elderly people are more likely to transmit the disease to each other compared to young children. This is a slide, and I apologize for the Danish, but it's because I didn't have time to translate everything. But this slide shows the testing patterns by different occupational groups. So on this list, we have different educational groups. We have people working in the bank sector, we have people working with travel, people working in public administration, and then we have people working with education and teaching. So that's mainly teachers. We also have people here, I've marked those who work within health and social care. And in this column, we see the number of people occupied in this group in Denmark. So for education and teaching, it's about 200,000 people. Of these, 63,000 people have been tested. So around 30% of the whole group. And 454 have tested positive, corresponding to 22% of the whole group. No, 0.2% of the whole group. So if we look at the percentage of testing positive, it's 0.7. If we look at the similar numbers for those working in health and social care, we can see that a higher proportion of this group have been tested, 43%, and also a higher proportion of the whole group tests positive, 0.9%. And we can see that the percentage of positive among the tested is much higher, 2%, compared to the teachers. And if we look a lot across all occupations, we see that the risk of testing positive is 1.2. So what I conclude from this is that it doesn't seem as if teachers has a higher risk of testing positive compared to other occupations, which would kind of support that COVID-19 transmission in schools is not a major concern. So to conclude, I'll say that children comprise a relatively small proportion of cases in Denmark. Children are less likely to be severely ill from COVID-19 compared to adults. Children are tested extensively in Denmark. We have a very high test incidence. We have seen no increase in cases in children nor in adults after the school openings. Only recently there's been an increase among children, but they have mainly been diagnosed through contact tracing activities in connection with very localized outbreak. And we haven't seen this increase in connection with the school opening. We can see that household transmission is responsible of 10 to 14% of all cases we see. And this proportion has changed during the epidemic. So it was lower during the lockdown and during the summer holidays. Children are likely to infect others within households, but they're less likely to get infected themselves compared to other age groups. And teachers does not seem to be in particular risk of infection. So I think what we see in Denmark actually support all the standpoints from ECDC when they list up the evidence for the role of children in transmission of COVID-19 in schools. Thank you so much.